What is TWS podcast episode, whatever, who cares at this point?
Bar. The rant with the vindicated.
It's my podcast and I do what I want to.
People, listen.
Word, is it still alive?
It's not working for me, Rich. All right, we're going to keep going.
I know I changed my voice at work.
Bars on the radio.
What is TWS podcast?
I'm ready. I feel like the end is staring at my watch and I'm feeling so new school.
Suicide attempts, how many tries to take?
They ain't ready.
All right, so I do this a lot, but this time I especially mean it. I apologize for what I'm about to say in advance a lot, but this time I want to be as sincere as possible. Like, I really do apologize for what I'm about to say in advance.
I'm sorry, I was trying to hold it in. My bad, go ahead.
Keep looking at the footage. Now, these are probably conversations I should have had with family members, but that's just not me, and that's kind of why I created this platform, to have a safe space for me to be able to get things off the chest and kind of work through my thoughts and hopefully, help some people at the same time. So this episode, I know it's going to hurt some people. Again, I sincerely apologize. My intent is not to hurt you, even though I know that is what's going to be the end effect of my actions. But this was the only way I could probably process these things. So,
right. Yeah, it's no malice, just closure and processing.
This is my mic,
damn.
I apologize for doing it in a public forum, but. No other way I could do it. Oh, and introducing herself for this episode is our co-host, Elise Camille. Hey, sweet pea. Hey, say hi.
Am I off right here?
I'll mute you. Can't hear you. Oh, there you go.
Testing. All right, there we go. It's like, am I on this show?
I got people turned off. I apologize for that one, Rich. Let me get on my apologies.
It's too late to apologize. No.
All right. But with all that said, this is the What is TWS podcast. We are at episode 45.
45!
Today, as always, I am J.Dot Flan. I got my brother Rich Herb with me.
You already know. Back for another one.
I got my little mini me.
Guest host.
All right. You want some applesauce? We're doing applesauce right now. Today, no what you're sipping, no bars. I'm not even going to do a rant.
Yeah, we just going right into this, you know.
Okay, this is for me a serious topic, so we can go right into it. I'm going to let Rich go ahead and handle some business real quick while I do this applesauce thing over here.
Yeah, while Jay Money's handling his fatherly duties. Nah, I just wanted to give do our shout-outs. One, to get everything out in the beginning so we can ramble on. So, once again, like as always, TT Charities. You know, Brother TT out here doing his thing. Doing it for big reasons. So,
Tavares Taylor, not
Brother TT.
Not Tessa Thompson.
Oh, shit. That's the did you? So, quick sidebar. Did you see the Thor Ragnarok trailer?
I did.
Tessa Thompson is in the Thor Ragnarok trailer. I'm just saying.
I don't even mess with those movies like that. Dude.
But TT looking good in the Thor Ragnarok trailer.
They just sold tickets.
So, all I wanted to say. But yeah, shout out to Tavares Taylor and TT Charities. You know, always out here doing good for the community. Giving back, so it's a great cause. As we always say, if you can't donate any money, just try to donate some time, donate a retweet, pass along the message, you know, anything counts. I'm also wanting to give a shout out to our boy Alex. You know, we always talk about starting your own businesses, and this brother did exactly that. Started his own hair supply business, Celebrity Hair Corp. You know, as they say at Celebrity Hair Corp, ladies, enhance your own natural beauty with Celebrity Hair Corp human hair extensions and let us make you look like the star you are. Let your soul glow. Let your soul grow. And their claim to fame, pay no tax and free express shipping. So that's celebrityhaircorp.com. So big shout out to Alex doing big things. Now we got that out the way. Like Jared said, we got a big, big topic, and it kind of hits home for both of us. Jared actually reminded me of this one So I've gone through similar things and throughout my life. So we kind of, once again, you know, it's that common background, that East Coast background. It's just so many similarities. So many similarities. But both wearing glasses with the tattoos on the forearm. Yeah, we could actually probably get away with actually being brothers.
Hey, me and Reg have switched IDs a couple times.
Man, it works.
It works. Yeah, Reg, you know. Our heights ain't the same, but
yeah, right. That's that.
That's that. They wasn't looking close enough.
Still got people calling me Jared at work, so.
Unforgettable.
But it is what it is. So, with that said, we're gonna go right into this episode.
Can I sit you down, sweetie?
This episode is all about families, and moreover, split families and extended families, and I guess long-term addition effects to families and the long term side effects of, you know, those things on children, on young men and women, if gone, I guess, unrectified, you know, the stresses that can cause and, you know, everything that comes with that, so.
So, I want to start out by saying, I lost my my great-grandmother, and was it, I want to say, late last week, lost my my great-grandmother, and, a woman that I've only known as Nana, found out recently, her actual name is Mary Russell, so rest in paradise, Mary Russell, Nana. But, you know, what it made me think about is, so I got the news from my my half-sister. I don't even, you know, like that term, but by half-sister, I mean...
you gotta get technical.
My sister, that's my mother's child, and now my father's child, but now my mother's child. So
here comes that's the extended or split family.
Split family, and I get in trouble. I got a lot of friends because, and this is where the hurt is gonna come in. Like I tell people all the time, when people ask me how my sister is doing, I don't think which one. So you know, to get real personal, I have that I'm aware of, I guess, four sisters, or no, three sisters. See how I'm confused already? Like,
it's the verbiage.
So I grew up with one, the sister that is, you know, my mother's child, and then my father has, that's how it is for me. So my father has three other daughters that are my sisters, and so, yeah, just trying to explain all this too much. But one of my half sisters, let me know that that Nana passed, and I appreciate her reaching out to me and letting me know. The hard thing about it was I didn't know how to react. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know, because in my mind, for her, you know, she just lost a great grandparent, you know, and from what I know of that side of the family. It was probably close. That's somebody they would have seen on a regular basis, you know, spent time with, been around growing up. So, you know, I knew for her, she just lost somebody close to her. And she was telling me, because I also lost a family member. But for me,
technically.
I mean, you know, she is my father's mother's mother. She is my great grandmother, you know, one way.
Any way you slice it, yeah.
But I don't have the attachment, you know, and this is no diss on Nana, because I can only remember meeting her like twice in my life. And it's very likely I've met her more times than that, but I can only really remember twice. And one of them is not a good memory, and it had nothing to do with her, nothing to do with stuff with my dad. But so I don't have, you know, when I heard that Nana passed, it was like, that's unfortunate, I'm sorry to hear it, you know, but I'm not feeling what she's feeling, and I didn't even know how to respond to or comfort my sister when she gave me the news. And then she and I aren't even that close. It just exposed to me how cold and sort of shut off I have become to like family matters in that sense. And now I have a daughter, and that's her family, and I'm either going to rob her of the chance to know and understand everything about where she comes from. Well, I'm going to have to build bridges and create relationships with people I don't know.
Yeah.
And it's something I'm torn about. I don't want to do it. I have no motivation. I have no inclination. There's nothing in me that says I want to go develop these better relationships.
Yeah, that stuff is tough. It's on one hand, you don't want her to, I guess, develop the malice or the hatred that's grown and the contempt from you. You'd want your child to develop their own opinions on something. Exactly. And it might be warranted, but that's something that she should find out for herself. But at the same time, because you're not there, you don't necessarily know how they feel towards you. So in not knowing them as a whole, because you're so disconnected, how do you trust your child with those people? Therefore, you would always have to be there. And you would always have that in your heart. So therefore,
it's not even that with me. So to get deeper, because this would be the most personal. I think I've said a lot of personal shit. I'm sorry. I think I've said a lot of personal stuff on the show, and but this will probably be by far my most personal show. So the issue, the reason why there's such a gap between the sides of the family. And I always seem to end up in a position in my family where I'm the bridge, where there are two sides that don't really communicate, and people find a way to communicate to each other through me. And it's usually because of my attitude. Like I don't care enough about anything, to usually get extremely upset or whatever. So I can deal with people because I don't give a fuck. Damn it, at least. So I don't have a malice or contempt or hatred for anybody on that side of the family. I'm 35 years old, and I've grown for most of those 35 years without a lot of involvement from my dad. I know who my dad is. I'm not one of those kids who doesn't know who his father is, never met his father. I know who my father is. I've met my father. I've spent time with my father. In middle school, one of my punishments was getting kicked out the house and being forced to live with my father. So I don't want to make it seem at all like my father is this missing character. I know exactly who he is, but we do not have consistent and ongoing communication. And throughout the years of getting to know my dad, honestly, I probably never said this to him, he's not a person that I look forward to being around.
Yeah.
He's not a person that I look forward to talking to. I think a lot of times, if I know I have to communicate with my dad, I immediately put a guard up. What is he trying to do? What does he want from me? What is he going to say? My father was the kind of person that blamed us for not knowing him.
Got it.
It was our job. We knew where he lived. We should have been calling him. We knew what his number was. We should have been reaching out and finding him instead of him trying to be involved with his children. And I guess like the malice in that sense is only growing now that I have a daughter, and I'm looking at what it's like to have a child and not being able to fathom knowing where that child is, knowing how to get to that child, knowing how to see that child and not do it.
Yeah, it's something, and I feel the same way. I know exactly who my father is, but he wasn't exactly there in my sister and I's life. And basically, same backstory, you already know. And so growing up without him, we at one point just stopped reaching out because you get tired of the empty promises. And then you get to the point where it's like, well, I'm going to cut this off because I'm in control of my fate now. So I don't have to rely on what you're telling me. I can provide this for myself. Even when it came to not necessarily monetary and extravagant or frivolous things, but it's just as a youth, you're looking forward to that actual time. You're going to spend time with me. You're going to have an activity with me, and you're going to do things that a parent is supposed to do. After a while, you cut that off. So I agree. Like that malice slowly begins to grow, and that contempt begins to grow.
Yeah.
And at some point, you learn to live with it. And you learn not necessarily to hate, but rather to just be without and become, I'm totally indifferent. Like, it is what it is until that person comes around and all of that stuff bubbles up and it comes to the surface. And then it's like, well, I don't want myself to feel this way. I don't like how I feel when you're around me. So you cut it off and you just stay away. I can totally see where that's coming from. And to your point, going through everything that Renee and I went through with Ryan, I like immediately, love of my life. So I've never gotten how you can be okay with not being in your child's life. There's no excuse. There's no good excuse. And you can't blame the child for that. You're the adult. You have to take ownership for that. And if you want your child to be the person who's going to look after you and come searching out for you, where are they going to learn the skill to search for you if it's not coming from the parent? You're absent. So therefore, your absence is creating their absence. It's a circle.
So my not wanting to be involved with certain members of the family or not creating relationships with certain members of the family is not because I don't want to have anything to do with them. It's because I don't think he understands how I feel about him. I wanted a dad, as a child, I wanted a dad.
Mm-hmm.
And at a certain age, when you've been wanting something all your life and it's been right there and it just refuses to be involved with you, like you said, you cut your losses. I'm 20-something years old. I've learned to live without a dad. Why do I still want one?
Exactly.
I'm good. Like I don't know what it's like, you know what I'm saying? It doesn't even feel like I'm missing something because I don't know what to miss.
Exactly.
I never had. So I'm just good at this point, mm-hmm.
Didn't Drake have a line like that? Like, I've been down for so long?
He probably did.
Yeah.
All Drake songs.
Yeah.
They've got relationships and something that didn't go right. So it's like, and I don't think my sisters grew up with him as a father. So the way they see him and the way I see him are completely different.
Exactly.
And I don't want to have that conversation.
Yeah, because you will never, it's just like this whole thing we've gone with politics. You're always going to have a difference of opinion.
Yeah.
There's not going to ever be a common baseline. Your view on a subject matter is totally different. It's an alternate fact. What you're going through, what you had to go through is 100% real. What their life was 100% real. And it's an alternate fact compared to what your universe is. You're never going to be able to have a good conversation. And it's always going to be like, well, you should forgive him. That's not what I'm here for.
And, it's just like I talk about the United States and racism. Like, the healing process can begin when the United States admits.
Yeah.
The day, I still don't think my father understands, why I feel the way I do. Or that I even should feel this way like that. I'm justified in looking at him the way I look at him. I don't think... He's never acted remorseful. He's never acted as if he even acknowledges that he did something wrong. And it's very hard to forgive somebody who doesn't even acknowledge
exactly that
they wronged you. So at this point, like you said, it's just I don't need an apology anymore. I don't need anything from you. What I would prefer is distance.
Exactly.
I'm good where I am. But now I'm faced with the idea of I have to erase that distance for the sake of my child. And now I'm going to have to build relationships with people that I've avoided building relationships with my entire life. I'm probably going to have these conversations. I'm going to have to hope. And the thing about forgiveness is you do have to forgive somebody whether or not they ask for it or not.
Yeah.
And it's like now I'm going to become, I got to come right up, face to face with that. Like, I'm going to have to find a way to forgive him and move on so that he can have, so my daughter can have access to him, he can have access to my daughter for, I guess, her well-being. And if one day, because my mother, the one thing, not the one thing, but one of the things I have to commend my mother for is she never spoke ill on my father. She never said anything bad about my dad. Her thing was always, I'll let you develop your own.
And then this goes back to what I was saying earlier, the child, she should always be able to develop her own thought process and her own opinion on it. Shouldn't be based off of what you guys think, but that's going to be a tough one because not only is it if you're not in that mind space and it's not something that you actively want to pursue, it's almost as on one hand, you're being forced to do something that you don't want to do, and so how do you even go about swallowing that pill? Like, how do you face that? How do you deal with that? And then if it's not actively something that you're 100% on and that you necessarily want to do, like you have to force yourself to try to do it, what happens when you get opposition from the other party? Or what happens when they're less than remorseful or forthcoming or anything, says, and they're becoming being a...
What happens when he says bullshit?
And exactly. And then now you still have to swallow yet an even bigger pill, right. Figuratively, not literally. It's hard. Especially being an adult, especially being a grown-ass man, sorry, Elise, and especially being a parent, because how you handle this situation will echo throughout Elise's life on both parts. You know, it's like, yes, you want to be the bigger person, but how much of yourself, for her sake, and then how much of yourself and what you want and need do you have to sacrifice and give up, especially when it comes to your mental and emotional well-being? You know, I feel like it's a fine line there.
And I don't think people at all recognize the damage that's done in these situations. It hurt me because my sister's never done anything wrong. My sister is, you know, there's no reason for my sister to be reaching out to me and tell me my great-grandmother died and for me not to be able to embrace her and say, I'm sorry. I honestly had no idea what to say. I felt blank. I was calling my mother, like, you know, I needed somebody to give me a script, like, tell like me how to feel.
Buffer and a go-between,
Tell me how to feel right now, because I feel nothing. And it hurts me that I feel nothing. Here is someone who just lost somebody important to them that should probably also be important to me. I don't feel any loss, and two, don't feel any compassion toward the person who just lost something. And now I feel like something's wrong with me, you know, but this is just the situation that I was brought up in. And these are defense mechanisms. These are things I've had to build up to survive and to be okay.
For decades, for years now. And going back to what you said, I feel like when people have their indiscretions and they go out and do what they're doing, I don't think they think about the long-term cause and effect of it. And like we were talking about this before, and I told you that my father has another daughter, and she used to come over for holidays, Thanksgiving, Christmas, things like that, and my aunts and cousins and everybody would be like, oh, Richie, your sister's here. And I'm like, who? Like, you know what I mean? And in the moment, I always felt like a jerk and an a-hole. But at the same time, it's like, you know what I mean? How should I be expected to feel? You know, this man was never there for us. He didn't take care of my sister and I. Absolutely ran out. My grandmother had to bear the load, raise all of her grown children, who are now grown adults who have their own kids, and then go back and redo it all over again. So I and then to have him with the in and out and all of his issues, like, I just developed a callous attitude towards him and nothing but malice. For you to come over and now say, here's my daughter. If you couldn't take care of your kids and you left, how could you now have another child and then bring that child around and I'm supposed to be okay with it? And see, that's the thing. And instantly as a child and as a youth and of this person, no matter what age you are, immediately your mind goes to, how could you not love me enough to stay, but you love them enough to be there? You know, it doesn't make any sense.
And I don't think, you know, my sisters, like, you know, understand. And it's not their fault, because I've never said it to them.
Yeah.
But when I'm on Facebook and I got to see a Father's Day comes around, and I see their posts about my dad and their pictures about my dad and on his birthday. You know what? You know, I didn't know when my father's birthday was until a few years. If you ask me right now, I don't know. I know someone has told me. I'd have to ask his mother to tell me again. I don't know his middle name. I don't know his birthday. I get questions on security forms and stuff about my dad all the time. Because I just don't know. And at this point, I don't care. Like, you know, like, I've made it this far. I have a wife. I have a daughter. Yeah. I have a job. I didn't go to jail. I'm alive.
Mm-hmm. No F's given.
You know, I survived the whole fatherless or father not around thing.
Yeah, you looked the stereotype in the face.
What's the purpose of
waved,
the day?
Waved your fish, you smashed it, and you're doing good. And I it's one of those things, it's like, I can understand, like, sometimes I wish, like, I was able to have a father, but then sometimes it's like, I mean, it is what it is. You look at other people's relationship. I look at Renee's relationship with her parents, and
that's cool.
Yeah, they had a great relationship, and a part of me wishes that I had parents that were there to take care of me and help raise me, but at the same time, I feel like the adversity that I had to go through made me the person that I am. I probably would not be striving and grinding and working as hard as I am and having as much ambition as I do and probably not sitting here on this radio show if it hadn't been for the adversity that I've been through, if it wasn't for the adversity that you went through to sort of push you into wanting to do more and wanting to have more, wanting to own your own and wanting to absolutely be that better person for Elise. So that absolutely plays a part in it. But now that I am where I am and now that you are where you are, you know, I'm good. I have a setup the way I like it. I don't need the outside interference. I don't need to look back. I need to continue to look forward and grow and do what's best for my job.
I have no inclination. There's nothing driving me. At 35, what do I need a father for? I've been in the father times since 35 years old. Some people I know at 35 have lost their father. Like, you know, you can make it 35 beyond without a dad. Like, you know, it's like, what do I need? And if I thought, like right now, to me, the relationship between my dad and I should be two guys that know each other.
Yeah.
But knowing my father, he's going to want to come along and be looked at as a father.
Yeah, he's as a father and grandfather.
Respected and talk to and want me to, you know, to act like a son would act around his father.
And
to
me, you wasn't just earned.
Yeah, to me, you were just another man I know. Yeah. We're two men in a room. And if you can, if you can approach me that way and we can talk like just two men in a room, then there's possibly, you know, some opportunity there. But I don't, you know, it's not even worth it to me to risk it. It's not even worth it for me to walk into a room and have him, you know, put on that fatherly air, which will piss me off, and then, you know, have to, like you said, swallow that pill, you know, for the sake of release. But I gotta do these things for my daughter. But, you know, to backtrack on what you were saying before, like, there was a long time where I was afraid of having children because that was the thought in my head, like, what kind of dad am I? I never saw what a dad is supposed to be like.
And I get that 100%.
It's supposed to be like.
If that was the prototype, it's like, I want to remove myself from
it. Am I going to make those same things? And then somebody once said to me, and it made a lot of sense, it is kind of, you know, the mindset I've taken into this, that I may not know what to do.
Know what not to
do. But I not know exactly what not to do. Mm-hmm. I know exactly what to avoid. And if I can at least avoid those things, I've done something.
Yeah. We're already on a better path.
And then luckily for me, you know, father wasn't around, but my mother had a lot of brothers. I had a lot of uncles. I had people that stepped in and even, you know, piece by piece took that role. You know, if one person was this piece and one person was that piece, I had enough males around me to step in and kind of feel that role.
To see the positivity.
Yeah. So I don't feel like I missed out on anything, but now I have this whole subsection of my family that I don't have a connection to, which therefore my daughter doesn't have a connection to, and that's a problem. And now at 35, I'm gonna have to figure out a way to fix that problem. It's not something that I'm looking forward to.
Yeah. I think something you touched on too is something that I'm happy about. You said if you're able to walk into a room and you're just like another guy, and you know, we've had our ups and downs. I think at one point I wrote my father a letter. I've always been heavy into the poetry. I've always been into the songwriting, the lyrics and stuff like that. So I think I wrote him something one time and read it to him that really hit home. When I was on my blog heavy, I wrote something out. And just it was very cathartic for me. And it was a great release. And I think him and I are at the point where he doesn't approach me as a father. I think we got to the point where he knows exactly what it is, and when he sees me, it's like, hey Rich, hey Rich, you know, because I'm his namesake, and you know, we call it a day. And I used to get mad at one point that he would just treat me you know, like another nigga in the street. But now I'm kind of grateful and happy that it's evolved to where I'm just another guy, because, you know, I don't have to fake the niceties and the pleasantries, and, you know, I don't have to, you know, feel like I'm forced to succumb to that feeling of respecting my elder and this is my father and all of that stuff. You're a guy, I'm a guy, how you doing, here's a beer, cool, later, catch you next time.
Like, this is probably a Father's Day. On Father's Day, I don't think about Father's Day. I've never had a reason to celebrate Father's Day. That's never been a big deal. But Father's Day comes, it's not even a...
It's like mental shutdown. You automatically skip over it.
It's another day. And so I had no plans on doing nothing. Didn't think about it. Wasn't, you know. And then, you know, halfway through the day, you know, he sends me a text to say, Happy Father's Day to me. You know.
It's like, do you feel like forced to have to say it in response?
Like before, I wasn't saying it, but, you know, but now it's like clearly, this is going to be, if I don't respond and say it now, then it's clear that I'm, like, I'm purposefully not acknowledging you on Father's Day. And I didn't, the intent was not for it to be malicious. The intent was there was no intent. It is what it is. Like, this is another day for me. I don't really care. And it's like that once he sent me the message, it's like now he's making my inaction malicious. So now I have to say something more. It seems like I'm just being an asshole for the sake of being. I'm sorry, Luis. I swear to God. If you go to daycare and say stuff, you're going to be a problem. She's in that parrot phase. Like
soaking it all up.
But, you know, I don't know, man. Just this whole, you know, losing that. And it's like, how many people even had their great grandparents alive? And I had a great grandparent, and just, you know, really had no relationship, you know, with her. And it's no fault of her. From what I understand from my mom, man, it was, you know, a sweet, nice lady. You know, because I had issues with my dad and my grandmother. I tell this story because I think I need to get this off my chest publicly. One of the reasons why, because I don't think maybe my sisters know that this happened. I don't think a lot of people know that this happened, and this may contribute to the fact that I kind of separate myself and feel a certain level of anger towards certain people. But when I was trying to go to college, I was graduating high school. I was not a good student in terms of grades, but I was an excellent test taker. And you know, when you take the SATs, they have you list, like, on the SATs, you can list like four colleges or something that you want your score sent to. You know, you can put like four colleges that you want your score sent to. Other schools will probably, you know, see your scores or something.
Yeah.
But you can say, I want them sent to
these
four schools. Mm-hmm. So to backtrack, I don't know what the statute of limitations is, but I lived in Maryland. And went to DC public schools. So in order to go to DC public schools, I had a DC address. And so the address, sweetie, you okay? You okay? So the address that we used was my grandmother's address. So filling out the SAT and everything, I had to go to my grandmother. My grandmother being my father's mother. So I put her information on the SATs. And I did really pretty well. I got a 1390 on the SATs. And at the time, the president of FAMU had come to another school in DC and said, any student that scored over 1,000, he'd give a full scholarship to. So I wrote a letter to the president of FAMU. I had my scores sent to the four schools that I wanted. And I sent back. I was like, you know, hopefully, you know, I get some mail. I get, you know, somebody to say something to me. And I never got one single piece of mail from the school. And I mean, it was a bad time for me emotionally. I couldn't believe that, you know, like, that I had fucked up this bad that, like, no school
reached out at all.
Like, if 1,000 was good and I almost hit 1,400, like, how could I? Oh. Why is she testing? She's testing me too. She knows she's about to hit that thing. It's like, how could I not get any attention, you know, at this score? Like, what did I do wrong? It wasn't until years later, like after I'd done the thing in Marquette and had to come back home. That's another story about things that people didn't do. I'll tell that story too. But it wasn't until years later that I realized that mail was all going to my grandmother.
Never reached out, never said nothing.
I'm pretty sure she was throwing it away. Pretty sure.
And see, stuff like that builds malice. Because it's just like, how different could my life have been?
How different could my life have
been? That's crazy.
I was like, man, I was so mad at FAMU. I was like, he couldn't even write me back. Like, I couldn't even get a response from the school. Like, you came to my city and said if somebody did 1,000, you give them a full ride. I'm telling you, I didn't go to that school, but I'm from that city, and I got a 1390, and anything you could do for me would help. And I didn't even get a response. I probably did. Never knew about it. And taking a step further with my mail going to her house, I did end up going to Marquette. I had to sign for grant. You know, I was 17 going to college, and so I had grants and stuff. So promissory notes were coming home, and I left school for Christmas break, tried to come back to school after Christmas break to register for the next semester, and I couldn't because I owed the school what, how many $1,000s, because none of those promissory notes had been signed for any of my loans. I couldn't sign for myself. And that stuff, again, mail goes to my grandma's house. So when people look at me like, you know, you don't talk to them, you don't say anything to them. I was a child. I was 17 years old.
I have a reason.
You know, depending on people to look out for my best interest, depending on my family, look out for my best interest. And people, you know, in my mind, it had to have been a conscious decision.
Yeah.
To do that.
Man, they were probably thinking about it just the same way. Just like,
call me.
Yeah, and just like, you know, it's they're your extended family. You're their extended family. You know, that's, you know, her son's indiscretion, prior indiscretion. Maybe they didn't wholeheartedly agree with the relationship. You never know what it was, but at the end of the day, that's not his current situation. They're going to wholeheartedly put forth an effort towards his current situation. Maybe his current wife or fiance, whoever it was, didn't feel good about it. They didn't want to make them feel away, so if that's who he's invested in now, that's who they're going to invest in now. And it's sad, but you had to take the hit for that. And it's like looking back in hindsight, like I can understand it. I can see where it's coming from. That's not how you do a kid. That's not how you do a child.
Okay, but you know, end of the day, you know, had things not gone the way they went, I would have never met Tammy. If I'd never met Tammy, I'd never have Elise. I wouldn't be here in Austin. This podcast wouldn't be happening. It all happened exactly the way
it was planned. Shout out!
And I thank you, everybody who was involved. Shout out to everybody who was involved. My opinion.
F-ups happen for a reason.
Hey, I'm good. I'm good. But yeah, you know. I wanted to do this episode because I just, I felt the need to talk it out.
Yeah. Sometimes, see, that's what it is. Sometimes you gotta just get it off your chest. You gotta let it out. Stop letting it eat at you. The more it eats at you, the more you keep it inside, hiding it in a closet, the more power over you it has. So you need to have these conversations, especially with the family, whether it's going to be direct or indirect. If any of your family, extended family, listens to the episode, you know, hopefully they get it, that it's not necessarily intentional. You're doing it on purpose, but it's not necessarily intentional. It's not done with malice. It's a byproduct of what reality is. And
if
should
have episode and you want to have a conversation, I'm all for it. Like I said, you know, me being who I am, I was probably never going to initiate that conversation. And if this was the most direct I could do. Getting it out and talking about it. Didn't mean to hurt anybody. Didn't mean to hurt any feelings. If you feel hurt or slighted by this, we can talk. We can have a deeper conversation. I needed to talk about it for my daughter's sake. All right, sweetie. Okay. What do you want to say?
She's like, I don't want to come back.
You want to say something? See, every time I get you up here, then you get quiet. Sing your ABCs.
Nope. But that was a dope episode.
ABC.
That was dope.
But let's see. Yeah, we're just about out of time. I was thinking we were gonna bring up those other topics. we can save them for that. So we're about at 40 minutes. That's how ready you are in terms of things.
You gotta get out. Yeah, as long as I'm online by like 7:45, gotta boogie through this traffic. Left work people to come meet up with my brother to go to work, to go back home and get back online to go to work. So that's IT for you. You gotta work remotely, do what you gotta do, but pays the bills.
I'm putting a double shift right now. I'm on daddy duty and podcast host. Say something, sweetie. You right there? Thank you. Yo, you got snot and everything. This is gross. Gross. All right, so okay, I want to end with one more story. You making noise? Okay. So I did episode 44 I did about my daughter and about the first 16 months of fatherhood, and it wasn't until today that I thought of the perfect anecdote to sum up the first 16 months.
Should be good.
So. My daughter Elise loves books. She has books all around the house, and in fact, she doesn't know the word book. She only knows the word books.
Mm-hmm.
So she'll run around the house, find a book, bring it to you. Books. You know, hand it to book. If you don't pay attention to her, she'll grab your hand. She'll put the book in your hand.
Oh, you gonna read this?
You gonna read this? And then she'll reach up, like pick me up, because you know, pick her up, put her down. Read the book. So it's the cutest, most heartwarming thing. You know, my daughter runs over to you, hands you a book, and asks to be picked up.
Yeah.
So she can sit on daddy's lap and read the book. But do you know the name of the book she asked me to read the most?
What's the book?
The book is called I Love You. And that's the first 16 months
shots
of fatherhood.
Fired.
That's the first 16 months of fatherhood.
I love you, mommy. That's a good one. It's true.
All right. But on that note, I guess we'll close it out. I appreciate y'all listening. I feel a little better. I do hope maybe some of my family members got a chance to hear this. And that I have to bridge this gap for Elise's sake. And like I said, no malice toward a lot of people. You know, I have feelings about my dad. I don't know if that'll ever get worked out, but I sure need to be able to have meaningful relationships with other people regardless of that. So I think I worked it out with myself, and I understand it a little better now. Appreciate you, Rich, for listening. And
you already know.
And going back and forth with me. But, yeah, love you guys for listening. And TWS is allowing a lot more content coming. I think we're trying to get the YouTube channels going now. We're doing some spin-off shows.
If you see the camera moving, that's the least.
He's just over there messing with the camera. Baby, come back. Come here. Thank you, big girl. So, now you want to talk. So, I know Evening with the Flans is going to start to be a regular thing. I'm going to try to do that maybe once or twice a month. And we got plenty of others that we want to spend.
Yeah, definitely got a lot of ideas coming up. You will see them popping up pretty soon. With that being said, peace. All
right, say peace. Say bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Just not going to say. All right, peace out.
Peace.